Starting off this list, in our number 10 spot, we have the Rhode Island Vampire. Admittedly, witch and vampire hunts aren't exactly a topic covered in most history classes, but this is truly a pretty crazy story. In the late 1800s, tuberculosis was spreading pretty rapidly in Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Vermont. This obviously would have been pretty terrifying for the residents of these places, but things quickly took a very dark turn. Since many of the people who were passing away from this illness appeared very obviously ill with sunken, drained faces, for some reason, the logical response was that people believed that they had been the prey of vampires. There was a family in Exeter, Rhode Island that had multiple people pass away from the illness, so some people believed that someone in this family must be the feeding vampire. They even went as far as to exhume the bodies of some of the deceased family members to make sure that they weren't undead. One of the exhumed bodies had passed away more recently, so her body was in better condition, which people of course took as a sign of her being a vampire. This led to them burning her heart and liver, and then they mixed the ashes with water. This is most definitely a crime today and pretty scary, but to make things even worse, they gave this concoction to other people in the town who had fallen ill as some kind of a cure. Imagine having to drink that and then still having tuberculosis after. Definitely not a good trade-off. In our number 9 spot today, we have India in World War II. It would be shocking to hear of a school not teaching anything about World War II, but it's often that we don't truly get the full scope of what went on. One thing I saw brought up a few times was the role that India played in the war and what they went through. Firstly, if you didn't know, India played a huge part in the Second World War. We normally hear of the large death tolls from the war, such as the 418,000 Americans who died, or the 450,000 people from the UK, which, don't get me wrong, is a huge and terrible number. But it is estimated that 3 million Indian people died in World War II, which is something I have literally never heard of anyone talk about before. India was fighting Japan, which for the record also had an extremely high death toll in this war, on the Eastern Front, and they were fighting Germany on the Western. World War II is a part of our global history, so why don't we talk about it and how it affected all of the countries? In our number 8 spot today, we have the Acadian Expulsion. Before I dive into this one, guys, please don't forget to hit the thumbs up button if you're enjoying the video so far. This is something that happened in my own country, you guys, and I can honestly say this was never taught at the schools I attended. The Acadians were descendants of the 17th and 18th century French settlers who settled in the area that is now the Canadian Maritimes. So, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and Prince Edward Island. In 1730, Acadians had to swear to British authorities that they would remain neutral on any conflict between Britain and France. Basically, one thing led to another, and the governor of Nova Scotia at the time, Charles Lawrence, saw the Acadians as some kind of a threat, and he also wondered why people who weren't from the area were allowed to live on such a beautiful part of the land. Well, isn't that real rich coming from someone who also wasn't from the area? But that is a whole separate conversation. Charles tried to force the Acadians to take an unqualified oath of allegiance to Britain, and when they refused, he imprisoned them and then ordered them to be deported. A man from New England called Charles Morris came up with the disgusting idea to surround the Acadian churches on a Sunday morning and capture as many people as possible while also burning their houses and crops. This whole situation led to approximately 10,000 Acadians being deported, and apparently this whole ordeal had a fatality rate of 53% for the Acadians. This whole thing is honestly pretty disgraceful, and it's just something that we don't talk about. In our number 7 spot today, we have the Iranian Revolution of 1979. On August 19th, 1978, at the Cinema Rex in Abadan, Iran, there were hundreds of people watching a film when 4 men barricaded the doors, doused the cinema in gasoline, and lit the whole thing ablaze. This was a key event that led to the following revolution of 1979, but it truthfully had been building for quite some time, and this obviously wasn't the only event that led to this movement. This revolution was unique in the fact that it lacked a lot of the usual causes, such as a defeat in war, or a gigantic national debt, or an uprising of those in poverty. There is a lot that happened and a lot that went into this revolution, and I truly do not have time to cover in this video even half of it. But this revolution not only toppled Iran's absolute monarch, but it had worldwide political repercussions that are still seen today. In our number 6 spot today, we have Cyrus the Great. It is entirely possible that you may have learned about Cyrus the Great in school, as he was the founder of the Achaemenid Empire, but there is one thing he did that apparently a lot of us didn't know that possibly changed the course of our history. After he took Babylon over, he freed all of the captured slaves in the city and let them go back to their homelands. This included the Hebrews who were captured and enslaved from Judea. This may seem like a nice and reasonable thing to do, but it truly was more than that. By allowing these people to be free and return to their homes and continue practicing their religions, this may have been what has kept some religions alive. Without this move, it is possible that we may not have Judaism, Christianity, or Islam today, and that would have made our entire history very, very different. In our number 5 spot today, we have the Italian Renaissance dark side. When we think of the Italian Renaissance period, it is known for development and the rebirth that it caused, which makes a lot of sense considering the word Renaissance literally means rebirth. But there is one less glamorous and slightly frightening side to this period that isn't widely talked about. Sailors who had been returning from the New World at this point brought something less than lovely back with them, and that was syphilis, which spread through an entire French army. After this, the troops brought what was called the Great Pox to the rest of Europe. Since there was no penicillin or banana medicine back then, the disease spread rapidly and the symptoms were pretty gruesome. It would often happen that a person who had fallen ill would have the skin on their faces essentially be rotting away, which would leave large ulcers. Some people's noses and lips would be pretty much gone, and it happened often that people would sadly pass away from the disease. So basically, what we think of as a beautiful time in Europe was both world-changing, but also very scary, and like, pretty close to a zombie apocalypse. In our number 4 spot today, we have the history of dentures. I suppose this one is less of an event and more of a weird practice, but I just had to include it. I don't have a ton of experience with dentures, but they seem to be a pretty straightforward thing these days, aside from the cost of dental, but things weren't always the way they are today. Instead of dentures being made of fake teeth, before, they used to be made with real human teeth, which is absolutely disgusting to me. After the Battle of Waterloo, scavengers went and took the teeth off of the corpses, which is quite a job, and then they sold these teeth to dentists. These dentists would boil the teeth, chop the roots off, and then attach these teeth to ivory base plates, and then sell them to the customers. Aside from this being an extremely morally questionable practice in its entirety, it is also just so creepy. In our number 3 spot today, we have telephone cats. If you're a cat person, you might want to skip over this number. In 1929, two scientists at Princeton University wanted to conduct an experiment in order to test how auditory nerves perceive sounds. This is obviously extremely important research, but the way they went about this is truly messed up. They took a sedated but alive cat and cut out a part of its brain. They then attached one end of a telephone wire to the cat's auditory nerve and then the other end to a telephone receiver. When one of these scientists spoke into the cat's ear, the other one could hear it on the other end. This is cool, but most definitely not an excuse to do something so inhumane. There were, of course, benefits to this experiment, and it is believed that this may have helped lead to the development of cochlear implants, which is, of course, an incredibly important scientific advancement. The worst part, however, while the cat actually survived this experiment, instead of treating it like a king for the rest of its life, like it truly deserved, these scientists instead decided to kill it to see if the experiment would still work on a dead cat. It didn't. In our number 2 spot today, we have the smallpox pandemic. I'm sure at some point or another, most of us learned about smallpox and the epidemic, which is something that we luckily don't really have to worry about much anymore. But one thing a lot of people explained that they didn't know was how badly it devastated indigenous peoples. Europeans who came over to America brought with them a multitude of diseases that they would have had some immunity to, considering it was likely their bodies had encountered it before. But this was not the case for those already living on the land that is now referred to as North America. Indigenous Americans not only had no immunity towards this disease, but also their traditional ways of treating illness may have only exacerbated the symptoms. Because of course, how could you possibly know how to treat something that you've never seen before and with no help from the people who actually do know? It has been estimated that the spread of this disease caused the population of Indigenous Americans to decline by 70%. That is absolutely insane. There's a theory that this spread of disease may have been one of the only things that led to the colonization of North America. In our number one spot today, we have the Tulsa Massacre. This is one that many people, including people from Tulsa, explained that they didn't really learn much about in school. This event occurred on May 31st and June 1st of 1921, and it has actually been called the single worst incident of racial violence in American history. This happened in the Greenwood District of Tulsa, Oklahoma, and basically just mobs of white racist people went out and attacked black residents and businesses. What started this was when a 19-year-old black man named Dick Rowland was accused of harming a 17-year-old white girl, and he was subsequently arrested, and there were rumors that he was going to be lynched. This, of course, drew a bunch of racist white people out of their homes to participate, but then a group of around 75 black men also showed up to make sure that he didn't get lynched. One thing led to another, and a firefight broke out that led to 10 of the white people and 2 of the black people being killed. After this, all hell broke loose. Just last year, the last living survivor of the massacre, R&B and jazz saxophonist Hal Singer, passed away at the age of 100. And just last year, this massacre finally became a part of the Oklahoma State curriculum, and it's about time. Only a century too late. I also feel like in that I didn't include, but I should have said, that thing after the lynching was like only the beginning of it, and then everything got crazy and way, way, way more people died, and it was really destructive. I just didn't want anyone to think that I was making it seem like it wasn't as bad as it was, because it really, really was. Starting off this list in our number 10 spot, we have Heraclitus of Ephesus. Heraclitus of Ephesus was an ancient Greek philosopher who helped push the notion that the universe is in constant change, as well as the unity of opposites, where the universe is a system of balanced exchanges. This is all fine and well, but where things get troublesome is in his own personal life. Heraclitus was a misanthrope, and his dislike for humankind led him to having long stretches where he was quite isolated. He would wander through the wilderness alone, surviving on plants and other things that he could scavenge. In the end, he came down with a pretty terrible and painful illness called dropsy, which is an accumulation of fluid underneath the skin. Doctors were unfortunately unable to help him, so he took matters into his own hands. He decided to cover himself in cow dung under the belief that as it dried, it would draw the moisture out from under his skin. This could have been a genius idea, albeit super gross, but things took a very, very dark turn. Covered in the dung, he laid out in the sun to dry, but the dung created a body cast and it left him unable to move. This inability to move also left him unable to shoo off the pack of wild dogs that ended up surrounding him. So, unfortunately, he was eaten alive. I guess I can understand why this one may have just been left out of history class. In our number 9 spot today, we have Kurt Gödel. The Austrian-American philosopher and mathematician Kurt Gödel lived from 1906 to 1978, and he made quite a name for himself. Being compared to the likes of Aristotle and Einstein, he is best known for his incompleteness theorem, which was a very significant mathematical result. He was obviously very successful and found himself teaching and educating a younger generation, but similar to who we just talked about, his personal life is where things got quite dark. When he was 6 years old, he had a case of rheumatic fever which left him quite ill for the rest of his childhood. This led him to first being pretty preoccupied with his health, and unfortunately this turned into hypochondria, which then led him down a path of complete paranoia. He ended up having an irrational fear of getting poisoned, so to avoid this he would only eat food that had been prepared by his wife, who also had to taste it beforehand. Sadly, his wife was hospitalized in 1977 for 6 months, which obviously left her unable to prepare food for him. I'm not exactly sure why he couldn't just prepare the food himself, but during this period he refused to eat, which eventually led to him starving to death. In our number 8 spot today, we have prohibition poisoning. I'm sure most of us learned about the prohibition at some point in school, which of course was the outlaw of the consumption of alcohol, which was done with a ban being placed on the production, importation, transportation, and sale of alcohol by the US government from 1920 to 1933, but it is just as well known that this ban certainly did not stop people from producing or consuming consuming alcohol. It was just done in sneakier ways. The black market for alcohol was booming as people began to drink redistilled industrial alcohol instead. This is all pretty well known, but one super sketchy thing that is definitely less well known is something that government agencies did to curb the black market sales of alcohol. Basically, they poisoned the industrial alcohol that was being repurposed for drinking. And not just poisoned in a way where the drinker would get sick, which is already horrendous enough, but they poisoned the alcohol with lethal chemicals. It is thought that by the time the prohibition ended, at least 10,000 people died from this. This event is still one of the strangest and deadliest decisions made by government officials. In our number 7 spot today, we have King Charles VI. King Charles VI started off his reign by being very well loved and respected, but as time went on over his 4 decades of ruling, he ended up being known as Charles the Mad. His erratic behavior had him hacking up nights, imagining that he was St. George, and he would also have bouts of amnesia where he would be able to recognize some people, but not his wife and children. This is all very strange and of course quite sad, as he was very obviously exhibiting signs of extreme mental illness. But one of the strangest symptoms was him believing that he was made of glass. He was terribly frightened of falling or being jostled too hard, and he would actually insert iron rods into his clothing to try and keep from shattering. But then he would also apparently run wild at top speeds throughout the halls of the castle or the streets, which would obviously mean he was totally abandoning his fear of fragility. It apparently got so bad that he had to be held inside with the entrances bricked up. Sadly, he continued on this path until he passed away in 1422. In our number 6 spot today, we have the sticky bomb. Okay. So this one is less of an event and more of just a historical invention that absolutely should not have existed, and that is the sticky bomb. After the British hurriedly evacuated France in 1940, they were facing the threat of German invasion and had to come up with some weapons that could be used against tanks. Thus, the sticky grenade or sticky bomb was born. It was formally called the anti-tank hand grenade number 74, and basically the design was that there was a metal outer shell that covered a bomb coated in adhesive. The idea was to have the user pull a pin to remove the metal casing, where they could then run up to a tank, use the sticky adhesive to stick it to the tank, activate the 5-second fuse, and get the heck out of there, or you could just throw it and hope it stuck. Well, there's a few problems with this design. The first one being that I'm sure all of us can understand, the adhesive didn't want to stick to anything dusty or wet or muddy, which are all things that happen to be common to tanks. You know what they did like to stick to, though? Human skin. Unfortunately, this invention could prove much more detrimental to the person who was attempting to use it. Despite these very obvious and dangerous flaws, it was still used by a few different armed forces, but I don't think anyone has used it in recent history, which is truthfully for the best. In our number 5 spot today, we have Bikini Island. Bikini Island is located within the Marshall Islands, and it once was the home of around 170 islanders. In 1940, the US president at the time, Harry Truman, ordered that the military test their nuclear weapons in the case of a future where they would be deemed necessary, since World War II had just ended, and people were of course feeling very concerned about what the future would hold. Since Bikini was located in a place where ships and planes didn't normally travel very close to, unfortunately it was the spot chosen for this testing site. The residents of the island were asked to vacate for the good of all mankind and to end all world wars, to which they of course obliged, under the impression that they would one day be able to move back. After this, the testing began, and in 1954, the US military detonated Castle Bravo, which is one of the most powerful weapons, at 15 megatons. There were 22 other weapons that were detonated on this island as well, so it's safe to say that this place got a ton of nuclear activity, which left it with extremely high levels of radiation. This left residents unable to return for much longer than anticipated, with the first returning in the 70s. But of course, shortly after these poor people moved back, they realized that the island still had totally unsafe levels of radiation, making it still unfit to live on, which has left it still uninhabited. In our number 4 spot today, we have Mansa Musa. Mansa Musa was a deputy to the ruler of the Mali Empire, but when the ruler went missing while on a sea voyage to find the edge of the Atlantic Ocean, Mansa Musa became the ruler in 1312. During his rule, European nations were really struggling due to civil wars and a lack of resources, but the Mali Empire was flourishing because of their abundance of resources like gold and salt. Under his rule, the empire grew to take up a large portion of West Africa, as he conquered 24 cities and their their surrounding districts. At the time, Mali was one of the top producers of gold in the entire world, which left Mansa Musa as one of the wealthiest historical figures ever. One of the most well-known events during his rule was his pilgrimage to Mecca. This journey took place from 1324 to 1325, and it spanned an estimated 4,000 miles, and it was the first time people outside of the empire saw just how wealthy he was. He traveled with 60,000 of his men, all wearing Persian silk, along with 12,000 slaves who each carried 4 pounds of gold bars, and he brought heralds who had golden staffs, along with a bunch of camels and horses. This pilgrimage had a profound effect on Egypt as this huge group of people passed through. From the markets in Cairo to the royals to the impoverished people that crossed their path, Musa left Cairo littered with so much gold that it depreciated the value of the metal in Egypt, and it took decades for them to recover. That was kind of just a whole mess. But like, we talk about like Napoleon and Alexander the Great and all the things that they did, and I've literally never heard of this guy before. And he's like one of the best conquerors, most successful conquerors of all time. Seems suspicious. In our number three spot today, we have the hostage crisis. In 1980, America saw Ronald Reagan win the presidential election over the former president, Jimmy Carter, but there was a crisis going on that was taking the attention of Americans everywhere. The Iran hostage crisis is well known in American history, and it began on November 4th, 1979, when 52 American diplomats and citizens were held hostage after a group of militarized Iranian college students took over the U.S. embassy in Tehran. The 444 days these Americans were held hostage is something I'm sure a lot of Americans learned about at some point or another, but the release of the hostages is what sometimes gets a little more murky in the history books. The hostages were released on January 20th, 1981, which was the day that Reagan was inaugurated. There were people who believed that the hostages were released because Reagan was simply just more powerful than Jimmy Carter. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that Reagan received a ton of credit for the release of the hostages, but truthfully, it barely had anything to do with him. The Carter administration had been attempting to negotiate with them for months, but they hated Carter because he had provided aid to the former monarch of Iran and had also failed an attempt to rescue the hostages before. So, while they certainly were released on Inauguration Day, it had way less to do with Ronald Reagan and way more to do with them just absolutely hating Jimmy Carter. In our number two spot today, we have internment camps. This is something that might be more well known than I think it is, but in my Canadian education, it wasn't something we talked about at all, which is kind of shocking. During World War II, President Franklin Roosevelt signed Executive Order 9066, which would cause 117,000 Japanese Americans to have to give up their homes, jobs, and businesses and move to internment camps. This was due to the fear of espionage after Pearl Harbor. This was truly one of the worst violations of civil rights in the 20th century. And the government didn't apologize for it until decades later, but they cited national security as the justification for their actions. Unfortunately, this was only the beginning as other countries began to follow suit, with Canada, Mexico, Peru, Brazil, Chile, and Argentina all having their own versions of this same kind of atrocity. It is very surprising to me that this is something that isn't discussed more often, as it of course is something that would prove detrimental to the Japanese American community for decades to come. In our number one spot today, we have the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire. New York City's Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire in 1911 was an unbelievably terrible incident that led to changes being made for factory workers in America. The Triangle Shirtwaist Factory was located on the 8th, 9th, and 10th floors of a building in Greenwich Village, and it of course was where shirtwaists were made, which we would now call a woman's blouse. I call this place a factory, but it was definitely more like a sweatshop, and the employees were mostly comprised of young women. So, like I mentioned before, in 1911 there was unfortunately a fire that broke out on the 8th floor, and because of the cramped and unsafe working conditions, the fire ended up claiming the lives of 146 people that day, which is absolutely horrible. After more details came out about the incident and how the terrible working conditions were mostly to blame for the amount of lives that were lost, protests broke out all around the city. People began demanding better for the women who had to work in these kinds of places. Like, just as an example, the doors to the stairwells and exits were locked so that employees couldn't take unauthorized breaks. How unbelievable is that? And the worst part is that the owners of the company, who were largely responsible for what happened that day, basically got off scot-free. If you want to know more about this fateful day, the amazing podcast My Favorite Murder by Georgia Hardstark and Karen Kilgariff has an episode that does a wonderful job covering it. The episode is number 189, entitled What Wonderful Luck. It is crazy, and there's a lot going on. Starting off in our number 10 spot, we have lobotomies. Did you know that it used to be common practice for people to just get a part of their brain cut out? Okay, well maybe not common, but it wasn't as uncommon as you would hope. Lobotomies used to be considered an excellent and efficient cure for things such as mental health problems, which thankfully is a practice that has not survived, for very good reason. Of course, in modern medicine, they do still exist, but only when actually necessary, and there is of course a lot more knowledge about the dangers and effects. One well-known person to have undergone one of these procedures was Rosemary Kennedy, who was John F. Kennedy's sister. She was experiencing seizures as well as mood swings, and while the seizures certainly were something that needed to be looked after for her health, I'm not sure if the mood swings necessarily needed some kind of medical intervention. Anyways, to cure her, they had a lobotomy performed on her. This procedure left her with the mental capacity of a 2-year-old, and she could no longer speak or walk properly. After this, she spent most of the rest of her life hidden away, and it was thought that her family did this because they were ashamed of her, which is both horrible and so sad. In our number 9 spot today, we have the English Civil War. This might be something that is taught more often in English schools, but admittedly, it's something I didn't even hear mentioned throughout my time in school. This was actually a series of civil wars that took place between 1642 and 1651, and while it is often referred to as one event, it can be divided into 3 separate wars. These wars were mostly in relation to the manner of England's governance, as well as pertaining to religious freedoms. The first war was from 1642 to 1646, and the second was from 1648 to 1649. Both the first and second wars saw supporters of King Charles I battling against supporters of the Long Parliament. The third war took place from 1649 until 1651, and this one saw the supporters of King Charles II fighting against the supporters of the Rump Parliament. In the end, these wars saw the execution of King Charles I, the exile of his son King Charles II, and the replacement of the English monarchy with the Commonwealth of England. There's so much more information about what went on and who was fighting in these wars, but I unfortunately don't have time to cover all of it in the short amount of time we have, but it certainly was a revolutionary period for England, Scotland, and Ireland, and it really was concerned with how these 3 kingdoms should be governed. In our number 8 spot today, we have William the Conqueror. This one is a bit more well-known than some of the others on this list today, but I want to specifically talk about one thing in reference to this that is much less well-known. In 1807, William the Conqueror decided to take on an all-alcohol diet. This is because he was suffering from extreme obesity and was struggling because of that fact. Because of this, he told his staff that he would only drink wine until his weight went down, but he ended up passing away less than a year later, and most of us are told that this was obviously because of the wine-only diet. But that's not actually true. In an astonishing turn of events, this wine-only diet actually worked. Shortly after beginning his diet, he was able to ride his horse again, which was one of the main reasons he started the diet in the first place, as he was previously too heavy for the horse to carry. He actually died after falling from his horse during an expedition, which was completely unrelated to either his weight or his diet. It's entirely possible that had he not gone on this diet, he would have never ridden his horse and maybe would have lived longer. Truthfully, who knows, but I suppose in a very roundabout way, he did still kind of die from this wine-only diet. In our number 7 spot today, we have the World War II dogs. A lot of us have learned quite a bit about World War II, as it affected everyone at the time and was obviously a huge deal. We all have slightly different perspectives on it depending where you grew up and went to school, but it's something that is still widely talked about today. There is so much to cover on this topic, so of course some of it ends up getting left out of the history textbooks, but that doesn't mean the knowledge doesn't survive in some capacity. For today's list, I want to talk about a technique that was used in Russia during World War II that ended up completely backfiring. In Russia, they had trained dogs with bombs strapped onto their backs to run under tanks. I'd like to think that this technique also saw the dog being able to leave the bomb there so that they could escape, but that is most likely wishful thinking, but that isn't even what I wanted to talk about today. While this is, I suppose, a good tactic for fighting a war, there was one grave oversight during this training. All the dogs dogs were of course trained using Russian tanks, since that's where and who they were being trained by, so when it came time for the real deal, these dogs couldn't differentiate between a Russian tank or an enemy tank, which then saw the dogs running under what they knew, which were the Russian tanks. Certainly not the outcome that they were expecting. In our number 6 spot today, we have Mary Shelley. We all know Mary Shelley as the author of Frankenstein, but there's one super creepy and kind of sad thing about her that is much less well known. Mary's husband was a man named Percy, and when he was 29 years old, he was sailing with two other men, and on July 8th, 1822, they got caught up in a storm and ended up drowning. The bodies of the men were found 10 days later, and they were only able to be identified based on their clothing. This of course is extremely tragic and sad, and of course it would have been so awful for Mary to have to lose her husband at all, let alone in this way. Percy ended up being cremated, and for some reason his heart was the only part of his body that refused to burn, which I guess now physicians suggest was due to calcification from an earlier bout with tuberculosis. While this in itself is pretty freaky, at first Percy's friend Lee Hunter ended up keeping his heart, but later it was turned over to Mary. Instead of disposing of the heart or doing anything normal with it, Mary ended up keeping the heart, and she carried it with her for years. No one knew about this odd little keepsake until a year after her death, when it was found in the drawer of her desk, wrapped up in the pages of one of his last poems. What a simultaneously heartbreakingly beautiful, but also ultra creepy story. The heart ended up being buried in the family vault with Percy and Mary's son after he passed away in 1889. In our number 5 spot today, we have strange medicine. It's not necessarily uncommon for us to hear about strange things that people in the past used to do, but sometimes those strange things are also disgusting. It was extremely common in the past for people to use human remains as a form of medicine. You'd think at some point they'd realize that these remains truly were doing more harm than good. Well, I guess we did, but it did go on for much longer than it should have. The cannibalistic treatments would consist of things such as blood, ground up human skull, and even human fat. Tomb raiders would even steal remains in order for them to be sold to the wealthy, which is incredibly dark, and apparently mummy remains were the ideal remains for these sorts of things, which led to a shortage of mummies. I never thought I'd be in a position where I'd be talking about a shortage of mummies, but truly anything can happen over here at Most Amazing Top 10. I guess who am I to judge these past decisions, but all I can say is that I am very glad this is one we have moved on from. In our number 4 spot today, we have the Chilean Civil War. Just to throw another war into the mix today, let's talk about the Chilean Civil War of 1891. The short of it on this war is that the president at the time, José Manuel Balmaceda, tried to give himself a lot more power than he probably should have had. The Congress weren't exactly thrilled about that, so they and the Chilean Navy rebelled against the president and the army. The Navy made the smart move by going north and seizing the nitrate mines, which were very economically important. From there, they sailed south. Like any war, there of course was a lot that went on, but ultimately the Navy and Congress were successful and victorious. This war was actually the first war where modern torpedoes were used and were actually successful, although it took all of the torpedoes they had in just one attack. Part of the reason the Navy was so successful in this war because not only were they able to dominate on land, but also sea. This really led other countries to realize how vital it was for them to have modern ships and naval defenses. It also made other countries realize how important it was for them to have modern weapons. This war may be lesser known and less discussed, but it certainly was an eye-opener for a lot of other countries. In our number 3 spot today, we have King Gojian of Yue. King Gojian of Yue had his reign from 496 BC until 465 BC. His reign took place during what was arguably the last major conflict of the spring and autumn period, and he was able to lead his state to victory, but it certainly wasn't an easy road or without some very creepy happenings. The major conflict he led his state through was the war between Wu and Yue, which started when a Yue princess, who was married to a prince of Wu, left her husband and fled back to Yue. I mean, this of course wasn't the only thing that caused the war, but it certainly sparked the fire. King Gojian was an extremely humble king, as he wouldn't relish in the riches he had, as most royals would. Instead, he ate the same food as peasants and often would leave himself hungry in order to to remember that he was in a position to serve his state. Okay, so you might be sitting there wondering when I'm going to get to the scary historical event that you came to this video for, so here it is. As I mentioned before, he was able to lead his state to victory, but of course a war involves a lot of sacrifice and some pretty horrific happenings. King Gojian's army was very well known for their ability to scare their enemies before battle began, and this is because their front line consisted of criminals who had been sentenced to death. In this time, there wasn't lethal injection or the electric chair, so naturally it was a lot more of a vicious process. These criminals would decapitate themselves in front of the enemy army. Yep, I think this is probably the definition of a scary historical event. I can't even imagine witnessing something like that and then having to proceed with a battle against the army that has people doing that sort of thing. King Gojian was certainly not a leader who was wasting time messing around. In our number two spot today, we have Topsy the elephant. Topsy was a female Asian elephant who was born in Southeast Asia around 1875. She was secretly brought into the United States shortly after and was unfortunately added to a circus who advertised her as the first elephant born in the US, despite that obviously not being true. During her 25 years with the circus, she gained a reputation as a bad elephant, and after she ended up killing a guest at the circus, she was sold to Coney Island's Sea Lion Park in 1902. The Sea Lion Park was eventually sold and renamed to Luna Park, and during Topsy's time here, she was involved in quite a few highly publicized incidents, which could be attributed to her drunken handler, the publicity-hungry owners of the circus, as well as the fact that this is all a perfect example of why animals that belong in the wild should be in the wild. In the end, all of the horrible people who had a hand in Topsy being in this circus decided that since she was such a problem, they would execute her publicly. They were going to hang her, but because people thought that that was inhumane, they decided to take a different route. For the record, I just want to say that the execution of Topsy was inhumane no matter what method they chose, because Topsy didn't deserve to be in this kind of an environment. On January 4th of 1903, Topsy was fed carrots that were laced with potassium cyanide, and she was also electrocuted and strangled. To make this horrific day even worse, the event was both spectated and the Edison Manufacturing Movie Company was there to film the whole thing. Many people believe Thomas Edison was actually there himself, but that is something that is up for debate. This whole situation is absolutely heartbreaking, and Topsy deserved a lot better than everything she had to go through. In our number one spot today, we have the Red Summer. The Red Summer is something I didn't even hear mentioned in school, which is honestly absolutely shocking. I'm hoping this is something that is more commonly taught than I think it is, because it certainly is very important. The Red Summer is the term used to refer to the period from the late winter through to the early autumn of 1919, in which white supremacists and racial riots took place in more than 36 cities across America. Some of the more well-known race riots that took place during the Red Summer were the Chicago and Washington DC riots, and the Red Summer also saw the Elaine massacre that took place in Elaine, Arkansas, which saw the deaths of between 100 to 240 black Americans. These anti-black riots are said to have developed from a multitude of post-World War I tensions, such as the economic slump and the competition in job and housing markets. In 1919, it certainly wasn't uncommon for there to be race riots and a multitude of white on black violence, but the Red Summer really marked some of the first race riots in which black people in number stood up to the white supremacy, resisted, and fought back. During the Red Summer, a civil rights activist named A. Philip Randolph publicly defended the right of black people to self-defense. It is said that between January 1st and September 14th of 1919, white mobs lynched at least 43 black Americans, but despite this, the state's refused to interfere or prosecute these mobs. Considering how many race riots went on during this summer, we truly could dedicate an entire video to the Red Summer. It is insane to think about how recent 1919 really was, and while we certainly have come a long way, there is always more work to be done, and part of the work involves us learning about these horrible histories and what happened in our past.